who no can violate for we temper, make me tell you that plain and simple. I'm Yasa Safari, and I full dose SPRB radio podcast with the 10-star general and Sharon Mango. Check them out. You won't be disappointed.
Greetings, Massive. This is Father Don, and I fully endorse SPRB radio podcast with 10-star general and Sharon Mango. Check it out. You won't be disappointed. Bless.
Hi, I'm Nana Genesis, and I fully endorse SPRB Radio with 10-star general Sharon Mango. Check it out.
I'm Sister Audrey, and I fully endorse SPRB Radio with 10-star general and Sharon Mango. Check it out.
This is Yami Bolo from out of Jamaica, and I fully endorse SPRB radio podcast with 10-star general and Sharon Mango. Check it out. You won't be disappointed. Bless your love. Yami Bolo for that.
Yes, bless. It is like turbulence to the future from the Tread on Mighty Camp. And I fully endorse SPRB radio podcast with 10-star general and talk about Sharon Mango. Check it out. Trust me, won't be disappointed.
I could have been one of the most notorious ladies. I'm still loving you, even though you're gone.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Greetings. My name is Diana Wright, singer, songwriter, and poetess. I fully endorse SPRB radio podcast with 10-star general and Sharon Mango. Check them out. Trust you won't be disappointed. Yes.
This is Jojo Mack, and I always tune into the SBRB radio podcast with 10-star general and Sharon Mango. If you love a good conversation, you should too. Check it out.
Stuck in commotion, right up there, radio.
The station with integrity, the station with a difference. Remember me tell you, Light Brown says so. Hold on,
stuck in commotion, right up there, radio.
We now stop till we drop. Sing, bless.
Greetings, my beautiful people. This is Shezzy, raising the awareness with 10-star general and Sharon Mango. Tune in and keep it locked.
Bang! Never sold from a travel with Shaka's only Ethiopia, Africa, when I laugh, when I lean, when I play, in the time you say it. Original Raising Awareness Show, we are talking about 10-star general, Yaman Sharon Mango. Bang, bang! Turbulence to the future, only man will like King Selassie, I jail! Rastafari, keep it accurate and royal.
This is The Buzz, your music news update for the latest on your favorite artists and more. Sponsored by JojoMadMusic.com.
Hello everyone, I am Pistol and this is The Buzz.
Peter Tosh's Live and Dangerous revisits the Billboard chart. Upon its release in 2001, Live and Dangerous Boston 1976 by Peter Tosh debuted and peaked at number 12 on the Billboard Reggae Albums chart. The concert, which was recorded live on November 26, 1976, at the end of Tosh's first American tour, concentrated on material from his Legalize It album. Live and Dangerous returns to the Billboard Reggae Albums chart, re-entering at number 4. The set benefited from the Record Store Day promotion, which saw vinyl albums being re-released at discounted prices. This is Tosh's 6th album to chart on the Billboard tally. The others are Scrolls of the Prophet, Best of Peter Tosh, number 4 in 2000, Super Hits, number 7 in 2002, Honorary Citizen, number 5 in 1997, Complete, Captured Live, peaked at number 2 in 2022, and Live at the One Love Peace Concert, number 12 in 2000. Ghanaian Afrobeat dancehall artist Stoneboy made headlines for statements made during his album release party recently, where he fired verbal shots, including expletives, at anyone who says they are the dancehall king. Dancehall lovers in Ghana believe that this was directed at fellow Ghanaian dancehall performer Shatta Wale, who is often regarded as the dancehall king in the African country. Much like the Beanie Man and Bounty Killer saga in the Jamaican dancehall sphere, Stoneboy and Shatta Wale have had a rivalry since 2014 when Shatta Wale took home the Ghana Music Award for Artist of the Year with the help of his hit song Dancehall King. In 2019, the feud heightened when Stoneboy was given the Vodafone Ghana Music Award for Dancehall Artist of the Year and Shatta Wale's crew rushed onto the stage. This year, the two will again go head to head as they are both nominated for the International Reggae and World Music Award, IRAMA, for Best African Dancehall Entertainment. Anyone who has played in the sound system arena knows of its competitive nature. Having been in the game for 45 years, Wagiti can attest to that. The South Florida legend was toast of an event at Backyard in Fort Lauderdale on April 29th. Artist, music industry players, Florida state and county administrators, and legislators packed the venue in tribute to his long career. Wagiti told reporters, quote, "Still playing after 45 years. It doesn't feel like it because I love playing music, seeing people dance and have fun. When I take them on a musical journey during my sets, taking them from 80s to 90s to the 2000s and beyond makes me feel good and appreciated by the audience, singing out the parts of the songs and vibing to my energy. That makes me full joy what I do." A quiet achiever of contemporary reggae, Norrisman recently copped an award for his debut album, which was released over 20 years ago. The veteran roots artist was presented with a plaque marking over 1 million streams on Spotify for Persistence, released in 2000. In an interview with the Jamaica Observer, the Sweden-based singer said the figures are proof of the album's endurance and quality. The song was produced by Colin Eilie Dread Levi for King of Kings Productions. Released in 1997, it was Norrisman's breakout hit and set the tone for his album of the same name. It featured members of the Firehouse crew as well as bassist Flava Holt, drummer Kirk Bennett, guitarist Lloyd Willis, and saxophonist Dean Frazier. Copeland Forbes, the former manager of reggae legend Peter Tosh, has rubbished long-standing claims that Island Records founder Chris Blackwell destroyed the Wailers group and has, instead, pinpointed Bunny Wailer as the man who caused the band's breakup. During a recent interview to promote his book Reggae My Life Is, Forbes was asked about a section in which he stated that while Bunny fancied himself as the intellectual center of the group, Peter, in his estimation and that of many others, was the most erudite, while Bob Marley was the smartest of them all. Yeah, I will forever stick by that, because a breakup was initiated by Bunny in 1973 after the first Catch a Fire tour because he didn't understand a lot of things like tour support, Forbes told broadcaster Richie B.
I am Pistol, and that, my friends, was The Buzz.
That was The Buzz, your music news update for the latest on your favorite artists and more. Sponsored by JoJoMacMusic.com.
Now here's a song from our sponsor, Jojo Mac.
I hear you talking about me, saying that I'm crazy, but I'm letting you see, you shouldn't have tried to play me. You're the one who's crazy. Talking about one night stand. You told me you were my man. Yeah, you told me about a little woman, but you said it was over and done. Now you're talking that crap, but you weren't saying that when all my body around telling me, baby, don't stop. I'm not the one, don't get it twisted. You ain't gon' use me, then dismiss me. You picked the wrong one, cause I'm insisting. You'll remember me as long as you're living. You should be careful who you talk to, then you wouldn't have to worry who'll stalk you.
How dare you call me crazy when all you used to call me was baby?
Friends and family, I'm Nana Genesis, and I fully endorse 10 Star General and Sharon Mango.
Sweet tune by Paulette Tarja, track entitled Giving You Up, and that was a production coming from New Ed Music Productions. And today we have a living legend. Yeah, we call him the iconic living legend. We call him UK reggae's and the globe's favorite son. Not true?
True.
Yeah, man. Let's see your awesome face, my brother.
Bubblers.
Boy, bubblers, may I tell you, the gremlins, them working overtime.
The gremlins are Jamaican, then the mother speaking home.
Listen, it's a blessing to have you on the show, bro. We're gonna dive right into it. And
okay.
Yeah, God bless you for being here. We did try to make this happen previously, but we had to cancel and make it happen, and he's here. He is a living, iconic legend. Do not mention bubblers without mentioning legend and icon in the same phrase.
Right. That's right.
Sharon.
Yes, sir. May I drink up my little tea? Bubblers. Greetings and blessings to you. It is an honor to be in your presence because primarily it's a media stateside and people know about bubblers. Right, me there in New Jersey and them know about bubblers. You are a legend, pure and simple.
Well, firstly, I'll say greetings to all your listeners. Greetings to everyone around the world. And I work with a lot of people and I just love what I do. So if they see me as a legend in their eyes, then it's up to them. I don't see myself a legend. I just see myself as a working musician. But yes. if the people see me like that, I'll accept
it. That's exactly how I see you. Like I said, born and raised in London, through and through. But I live here in New Jersey.
Yeah, I'm a Cockney, mate. Cockney.
Yeah, I mean, Andrew said it's a Cockney, you know. But I'm here stateside and your name is synonymous. You understand? So,
okay.
Legend is what you are. And that's take that with honor, man, because this is the US. You know what I'm saying? Them picky about things. But when people talk about bubblers, you know bubblers. Yeah, I know him. Because I'm from England, right? Yeah, I know him. He's my friend. I'm going to tell him that. Well, let me know you. I know I'm my friend, you know. That is my friend. You know, where I come from, the same place, right? But yeah, it's an honor. It's a complete honor. We finally got you. I know. Your schedule is busy, you're just all over the place. But thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us today. We sincerely appreciate that.
My absolute pleasure.
We're here to honor you. You understand? This is not like an interview. We're here to honor you.
Thank you very much.
Your history. We are giving you flowers today. If nobody never give it to you, we are giving it to you today.
What kind of flowers are you giving?
Thank you.
I want to know what flowers you're giving him.
Flowers of love and appreciation. That is what it is. We're geeked to there.
All right, we are spelly talk.
Yes. All right.
So Bubblers, thank you once again for being there. You're a humble guy, and you know, that's why we even love you even more. You know, a lot of the time we tend not to say how we feel about the people who make us feel happy every day, the people who give us the right kind of music, the right kind of vibration, you know what I mean? And it always seems to be when people pass away and then we say the words, you know, and it's like, I wish they would have said this while the person was alive. Why not just...
That's so true.
And then, you know, you tend to see everybody who you haven't seen in donkey's years and they're saying all these lovely words, but why you never say it while he was alive?
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean?
That's so what we give it to your fans.
I do these shows, which is to honor in their lifetime. You're one of those. So today we're going to dig into it. I want to refresh your memory because... When I wanted to come into music itself, and that was like maybe over 20 odd years ago, there was two people who made an impact on me, you know, and one of them was Horace Andy, and he sat me down, he gave me an A to Z guide of what to do, what to be careful of. The other person, I was speaking to my brother, I said, D, man, I want to get into this music so bad. He goes, listen, I got a friend, you know, who can help you out, right? And I said, okay, who is that? And he goes, don't worry, I'll take you to him. I used to go to school with him. And I said, what's his name, though? And he said, Bubblers. I said, which Bubblers? Because I was always familiar with only one Bubblers from Rough Cut when you guys were still at Wheelsden, just off Wheelsden High Street, right?
Yes, that's right. Yeah, we had a student there, yeah.
Yeah. So So I said, which, are you talking about that, Bob? He goes, I don't know. I just know he's into music. And he took me to your house, and that's where I met you for the first time. And I realized you and my older brother were childhood friends from way back when, Roundwood Park, and you're still in the same place.
I'm still in the same place. I bought the house for my dad, so I'm still in the same place where I grew up.
Wow.
You know, but I love it here. I really love it. I'm so familiar with it. I've grown up here, and I'm still here.
Right. So big up yourself, and you've worked with so many people, especially when we talk about who have you worked with in your career. I think we both established.
That's not fair now. That's not fair. That's not fair. I tell you what, it'd be easier to say who I haven't worked with.
That's what we established.
That's what we're saying. Who hasn't? He worked with who hasn't? Not who
it'd be easier for me to say that.
Yeah.
If I don't mention the people then who have worked, they're going, oh, look out my name.
Exactly.
It's too much people. It's too much, and I say that with no boasting. It's just a fact.
I've got your resume.
There's so much people over the years. There's so much.
Yeah, we got your resume, so we know.
I could tell you for a fact. I haven't worked with Bob Marley, and I haven't worked with Bunny Wailer, but I've worked with Peter Tosh.
Right.
I haven't worked with Bob Marley, and I've worked with Bunny Wailer, but. But majority of the artists, I'm talking old school artists now. Yeah, and majority of them, I've worked with all of them,
right?
From Gregory Isaacs to John Holt to Dennis Brown to Horace Sandy, you name it, everybody, Big Ute, everybody.
Well, I tell you what, we're gonna take you down memory lane. Now, first and foremost, we want to talk about childhood. First and foremost, take us back to where you grew up, what life was like.
Hold on, I must say first, and the UK artists, they're gonna kill me if I don't mention that. And the UK artists, talking about Brown Sugar, Michael Gordon from Investigators. I'm gonna mention that first, so I'm gonna leave them out.
you saved yourself from that rope around
the neck. Yeah, I can see myself against the ropes right now. You know, but you were saying.
Yeah, take us back to where you grew up. What life was like growing up? The vibration at the time. You know, give it the full name.
Where can I start? Without going too deep, well, my dad was a man who used to like music. My mum and dad, back in those days, they weren't clubs for the adults to go to, so they used to make their house parties and they invite their friends over to the weekend and they cook and them thing there and they have them partying in the front room. Mm-hmm. So I'm about 4 years old. I haven't even started school yet. So my dad used to have a party trick. All his friends are around, and he'd go, Carlton, play this tune, and he'd sing the tune to me, and I'd go into the record box, and I'd find it. I can't read, you know, but what it is, do you remember in those old days, most of the people, when they have their tunes, they used to scratch off the names off the records.
Right.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
So how I'd recognize the records is the way it was scratched off. That's how I used to recognize it. He goes, yeah, go and play this tune, rah, rah, rah. Go and play that tune, and I'd go and find it. I look for the tune, and I look for it, it's scratched off, and I go, yeah, and I'd play it. And everybody goes, I'm doing that. But to me, it was a second nature. I just knew it by the scratches, the records were scratched off. So that was my introduction into the music, because my dad had a varied, he listened to, like, as usual, with our parents in time, they had these Johnny Ace albums, and they had Dusty Springfield, and they had the Tamla Motown, and they had the reggae, and they had the ska. So we had a lot of kind of diverse things, and those Sunday music, what do they call them? Sacred music. secret music. That's a secret. They're sacred, yeah. So that was the vibe of it. And growing up now, I'll go a few years forward. I'll make it kind of, I have to say this. in my area here, where I was born and grew up, a stone's throw away from me, literally a stone's throw away from me, was Trojan Records. Literally like a couple of streets away from me. The site right now, where that site is now, it's called Wilson County Court. That's what it's called now. It's a courthouse.
So
the site of that used to be called Trojan Records.
Right in the corner of the roundabout.
Yes, 12 Neasden Lane.
I'm with you.
That used to be Trojan Records, and up the road was Palmer Records, which was on Soundville, which was on Craven Park.
That's right.
So, and then on my road now, there was a Jamaican Chinese guy called what is it, Roy, and he had the first patty shop. He was called Mr. Patty.
Mm-hmm.
And also you'd have all the artists them when they're coming out of Trojan or they're leaving Jets Mr. Palmer, which we know evolved into Jetstar.
Before that,
when they were hungry, they'd come on my street where mm-hmm. Roy's shop was. Roy's shop was literally a couple of doors from my house. So right. I could be looking out my window as a youth. And I could see John Holt. I could be seeing Ken Booth. I could see all these artists coming to get their food. And my mind's just being blown. I'm going, Dad, Mum, look. Right, you know, we had the album covers, so I recognized their face.
Right.
The album covers. I could see these artists pulling up to get their dinners.
Right.
And getting order their patties and order their rice and peas and all that from the same shop. So it's like. I was being drawn into the music whether I liked it or not.
Right.
That's the only way I could see it because I'm gonna go forward again. I'm going all over the place. But
yeah.
I was doing some sessions with Sly and Robbie.
Mm-hmm.
And you record a couple of tracks and we're talking and he goes, Bubblers. He goes, one thing about music, because music called me, you know. I never want going to music, you know.
Mm.
Music called me. He goes, I could have got myself in a whole heap of badness and things like that. And I feel the same because music called me. I didn't know I was going to be a musician or anything like that. It just called me. It just called me. I feel the same way how he says that. When he said it to me, I said, boy, I feel the same because I didn't know I was going to end up playing music or doing anything like that.
Right, right. What school did you go to?
But going back now, into those Trojan days and all that, around me, right, up the road from me was Simran's, which is not at the top of my road.
Oh, right.
Simran's, which is where Winston Reedy come from and all that.
DJ.
Then you had the Mohawks, one of the Mohawks. You know, I just remember Mohawks. One of them used to live in my house here. You know, a girlfriend lived in my house here.
Right.
So I was always surrounded by this music. It was pulling me. And I didn't know why, but, you know, it's pulling me towards it. And all I used to do is just listen to records as a little kid.
Mm-hmm.
And another thing drew me to get, my mum was a dressmaker. I'm in my studio now, in my house. Mm-hmm. This room used to be my mum's dressmaking room, where she's a seamstress. Right. So she's dressing. So in those days, people used to get married for weddings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so... In those days, we used to get invited to the weddings as a dressmaker. My mum used to get invited, and sometimes they used to make the last alterations at the wedding. So they'd invite us. So we'd be invited to all these different weddings to go to, and so we always used to arrive first because my mum had to arrive first to make sure the dress was fitted, and my dad used to drive us as me and my sister as kids, you know, making sure we were there and make sure we were all right. And you know what, they give us a little party and a drink, and we'd be sitting while it's all man never set up, and they'd be thumping some tunes, you know. And I'd be watching the light, because them days, the sound box used to have lights in it and all those things like that. Mm. So you know, you're really mesmerized by this and this heavy sound,
right?
And so my family was invited to all these different weddings, and so again, that is another music was pulling me in. And I remember listening to these two particular tunes I used to listen to, which I didn't know were Studio One tunes at the time, but
right.
I learned that years down the line. But one was a tune called Baby Why by the Cables.
Why?
Baby, why? Oh, why?
Right.
Why did you leave me and you run away? Girl. And that tune needs to do something to me. I don't know what. I just love listening to that tune.
Mm.
If I was a naughty boy and you put on that tune, that would calm me right down.
Right.
It just soothes me. Mm. And another tune was Nanny Goat.
Larry Master.
Nanny Goat.
Well,
you know, BS, I'm like, what? I don't know if it was a hit tune.
Yeah.
But I just used to like those tunes. And only years later, I found out those Studio One tunes. But right. Those two tunes, and every time, everywhere we went in that time, because it was that time when our tunes were released. So we'd hear that in all these weddings we were going to.
Right.
And I'd go to weddings going, I hope they play that tune, you know, and I hope they play it. And then lo and behold, they play. And I was as happy as a lamb. Give me a party and a drink. And play those tunes, and I'm happy, totally happy. But that's my kind of introduction to music without playing, just being drawn into it.
Right.
I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's as well as, you know, growing up in the UK, you know, which there was a lot of racism as well. How did you cope with the racism and school life?
I personally never encountered it. Okay. Personally.
Right.
I'll give you an example. On this street where I live now, mm-hmm. on this road or in this area where I live, there used to be Jamaicans and Irish.
Mm-hmm. And they were one.
And we got on like a house on fire.
Right. True.
Yeah.
We looked out for each other.
That's true.
Like, for argument's sake, if I'm coming from school and my mum and dad's late coming home from work, they'd bring me into the house. Go, your mum and dad don't come back yet? I go, no. They go, come in. And they give me a cup of tea, they give me a sandwich, and I play with their kids until my parents come and then they bring me to my parents.
Right.
That's how it was those days.
Yeah.
Right. We got like a house on fire. I never ever got no animosity from them or anything.
Right.
I never felt that.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of Irish on the street and a lot of Jamaicans.
Right.
And that was a lot that encounter from most of the era I was in around here.
Right.
So racism, I didn't encounter racism in any form, really, but in my lifetime. Like, even my school, even right now, I got there's a WhatsApp group with my school mates.
Mm-hmm.
We're all big men. We're all over 50. As far as I put it, we're all over 50. But we got a WhatsApp group.
Okay.
And there's Indians. There's white people. There's Greeks. There's a whole bunch of different people. And we all got on at school.
Right.
I can't remember where anybody's going. Oh, you this and you that. Nobody called anybody. We just all got on.
Right.
We'd have a little bickerings, but it was never racial.
Right.
So for me, I never really experienced that until I left school and got out into the big wide world and saw things. You know, my blinkers were taken off.
From a different perspective. Yeah.
Yes.
Now, before I had...
Wow, I didn't know that was going on. I know we were kind of second-class citizens, but I didn't know that was really going on.
Yeah.
Where I was growing up here is high amount of Jamaicans and West Indians. So you kind of blinking from that because you're amongst your own people in this area.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're kind of shielded from most of that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, for me, you know, because I was born in West London, Kilburn, Queen's Park, that kind of area. And growing up there...
Irishmen run down there too.
Yeah, we had loads of Irish. And I guess we went through the same struggles, you know, the Irish, you know, and Caribbeans, Africans, we all went through the same struggles. But the word,
well, you know, they call it Irish. The Irish is the black white man. You know, them call him. You know,
exactly. Yeah. That's what them call it.
Yeah.
You know, and because I remember it, you know, and the reason why I bring up racism is because I saw my dad experience it, and when he experienced it, then you know, because everywhere my dad went, I was with him, and.
Mm.
Time we went into a laundrette, and that was terrible, you know, the names that will call my father and stuff. So those things stuck with me. And then when you talk about the Teddy Boys, the skinheads and all that kind of stuff, which is why back in my time, which is not too far off from your time, where, you know, we had to walk around in groups. But I guess Black people's awakening came when Roots came out. And then everybody kind of realized who they really were, because Africans and Caribbeans, like Jamaicans and Africans, were always going head to head. But that simmered out when Roots came out, was like, Jesus, so we're all African.
Because that helped us, that helped them to understand our story as well as understand their story.
Yeah. So
But to add to what you're saying, though, I'll tell you, there was a kind of race aspect which you just reminded me. At the bottom of my road, there was a pub called the White Horse Pub. And they used to have, every month, they used to have a Teddy Boy gathering. Mm-hmm. All the Teddy Boys used to gather around there. And when they were there, you wouldn't see no Black people around. We just keep away from them. Because the tension kind of got a little bit higher there.
Yeah.
But there was no fight or scuffles, but you know, the tension was higher. They thought that when they came, they don't want to hear nothing from no Black people or not. They don't want to come and do their jiving and their dancing and they go home. And that was it.
Right.
They weren't talking to us and we weren't talking to them. But that's the only thing I've it wasn't racial, but it was that tension. But that's you just reminded me of that. But they used to have that for about at least 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
And they have like every month they'd have a Teddy Boy night. And they come out with their Teddy Boy clothes and then the girls and the dance and everything like that. And when they came, everybody just kept clear of them.
I guess we let off a little frustration during carnival time. That's when we unleashed some heat.
Yeah.
Back in those days. Yeah. You know. But anyway, let me come to Sharon Mango. But I wanted to really touch upon, you know, what you wanted to become before you left school. What was your ambition?
You know, by the time I'll give you a little story, but very quickly. When I was transitioning from junior school to high school, I was going to a school called Keeble School, which is just down the road in Harlesden. So I was going to secondary school now. So my dad picked the school for me. Like you know, you can put down three choices on on a form. My dad put down John Kelly 3 times.
So
I don't want you to go. I don't know why you go at these other school. Why you go at school where you just can't keep your head in your book. I said, but you haven't been there. Nobody's been there. None of us have been. He goes, but yes, we know about the school. Yeah, that's where you go. I go, okay, cool. All right. So I went to John Kelly. So you know when that the just before September comes, in the summer holidays, they have a parents kind of day where the parents come down and can walk around the school.
Yeah.
So they can see what the school, what the grounds are like and what the kids have been learning. So I went, me and my mum went to one of those. So we went to the science block, the maths and the English. So we went to the arts block. We were on top of the arts block in John Kelly. They got a music block. So when I went up to the room, each room has got a piano in there. And it's about 6 rooms, and they've got a piano in there, and 2 of the rooms got a drum kit in there. I said, "Wow, hey, wow, okay, all right." So the person's talking, the person who's walking us around is talking.
Yeah.
I see my mum walk up to this piano slowly, and see the person's talking. I'm watching her, and she just goes up to it and hits the note, bing. Loudly, you know, to the whole place turned around.
Mm.
And I looked at the note, and I remember to this day, it was a G note.
Mm.
And I said, "Mom, why did she do that?" And she looked at me.
Mm.
And she looked at the man, and she smiled.
Mm.
And we carried on. And after we came, I said, "Mom, why did you hit that?" She goes, "I don't know why, I just felt like hitting it. I don't play music, but I just felt like hitting it." And to this day, I always remember that note. It was a G note.
Right.
I don't know if she was summoning me to play keyboards spiritually. I don't know what. But I remembered it from that day. And from that day, I was suckered onto the piano, onto the keyboard. Every chance I got, I wanted to play keyboards. Every chance.
That was your awakening.
Wow. That's
Yeah,
that's,
but I think that's what, it, what I'm saying. I don't know if she spiritually summoned me. But I was 11 at the time, just about to start John Kelly. This is like the preliminary before you start in September, when they have the parents meeting and they come down. So right. I said, yeah. All I can remember when I started school, I go, yeah, I just want to go to music block. I just want to go to music block. And then what it is later on now, after about a year or two, they told us said, well, the music, for anybody who wants to go to the music blocks in the playtime, you can go down there during playtime. Me, my brethren, my lifetime brethren, Don Campbell, Dilly from Stingray, all of us went down there. We just all went down there. We go, yeah. And there was older kids than us, older students. Like, we were like in year two, they were in year four. And they were playing all the latest tunes, all the tunes like Caught You in the Life from Louisa Mark. Wow. And I said, what? My head had burst. I said, well, this is great. And they're playing music. They play that tune, you know. They play that tune. Mm. And every other day we go down there and play a new set of tunes.
Mm-hmm.
And that took me right into it. Right. That took me head on. I didn't know. I do my metal lessons, but all I could concentrate on, can we go down to the music block later? Or can we do this? Or can we do that?
Right.
I slightly went off track then, didn't I? I didn't mean to, but yeah. But I'm just telling you.
Yeah.
How I got from a young star, how I got into the music.
Right, right.
It's like, it just suckered me in. It just suckered me in.
Sharon.
I think it's amazing that your mum, when you went to that preliminary, you know, meeting, that your mum just walked up to the keyboard or the piano and hit the G note, right? Because I thought you were about to say, it was like, oh, your mum played and she didn't tell you, but your mum didn't play
no. She doesn't play. She says she doesn't play, and she just went up to the man's the person who's talking, is walking us around, he's talking, and in the middle of the talking, she's like, bing, and she didn't hit it softly, she did it loud. So I just kept my mouth shut as you do as a kid. And I waited till I got home. I said, Mom, why did you hit the keyboard like that? Why did you do that? She's like, I don't know. I just felt to do that.
Mm.
I don't go near piano or anything like that, but I just felt I needed to do that.
Mm.
Yeah, that's deep though. That's real deep. So
it is.
So for you, I know.
And from then.
That's going to stay with me forever because it's so spiritual. That was such a spiritual moment.
Yeah, I've always said that to myself. I said, I don't know if she was summoning me to play keyboards or get involved in music, but that when she hit that note, that whatever she woke up in me, that was it.
Mm.
So then you started to take lessons now because you of yourself don't play no instruments, right? So
No. I was getting lessons from school, like the basic lessons. We had a teacher called Mr. Gray, and he'd come in the class and he'd be, you know, teaching the rudiments of music and that. He goes, "Hey, have you heard that latest Burning Spear album? Have you heard that?" I go, "We know about Burning Spear, sir.
Right?
We know about." And he goes, "Yeah," and he's telling us all the tunes of like Marcus. He was, he knew what he tuned them. And I go, "Well, I go," and he had I remember that ginger beard, and he had ginger hair.
Right.
His name is Mr. Gray. And so he goes, right, I'm going to show you the rudiments. He goes, I know a bit about reggae. He goes, and he goes, these are the building blocks. He goes, you've got, you know, a first, a third, and a fifth note, which is a chord, a basic triad chord. And he starts the basic building blocks. And that's him, gave me the basic lessons of how to work out chords and that. And that was it. From he gave me that, I started to, any chance I got, because I didn't have a keyboard. And in our school, we used to get, they used to give us melodic, you know, we can blow in the
tune. Yeah, the recorders and all of that, yeah.
So we get a couple of melodicas, and me with my fast, I was not going to sneak out one, I'll be honest, we got T-Fort one. I'm taking over, and I'm going, and I'm working this melodica, I'm going, yeah, what's, and anything I didn't know, I'd go to somebody else will ask him, well, how do you do this? And I listen to chords. And then I work, and from there I self-taught myself.
Mm.
But even to this day, they call my way of playing, I play what they call unorthodox. I never had schooling of how to play keyboards. I just put my fingers in the notes to make them fit.
Right. So you play by ear then? You play by ear.
Yeah, I play by ear. Unorthodox. So sometimes I got my keyboard brethren called Bigger Morrison. He's the man tell me because they have certain scales to play. And I find it really difficult to play. He goes, Bubbles, you don't have no fingering. I go, no, well, what's that? He goes, yeah, you got a finger. He was schooled by a proper keyboard player, a keyboard teacher. He goes, no, when you're playing scales, you have certain things you have to do.
Mm.
If you're playing and pushing your fingers in the notes, you'll never get it right. You'll never make it sound smooth.
Mm.
And I sat down with Bigger. He'd give me lessons to say, no, you play like this. And he gave me the right way of how to play. And that was another revelation to me what opened up. I said, oh, you don't know, just push your fingers in there anywhere and make a sound. Mm. And I had to learn. I learned from all my peers around me over the years, but they call my style unorthodox because I'm not playing as the schooled way.
Right.
I'm a man who push my fingers in and annoy them and make them fit to make the sound.
Right.
But somehow, over the years, it's worked for me. But in the same time, I've adopted the official way of playing. When I used to meet other keyboard players in the beginning, in the early years, they say, how do you play? How do you play like that? What are your fingers set like that? I said, well, that's how I know to play. I never got schooling. You're telling me about schooling. I never got schooling. I was self-taught.
Mm.
So you just basically learned the fundamentals of notes, right?
Yes.
And then everything else.
And I just did my own thing from there.
And then you did your own thing. I mean, sometimes it's just like that, isn't it? You know what I mean? You wasn't trying to be classically trained. Your teacher at that time, to even talk about a burning spear, and it's like, I'm going to show you this is how it's just rudiments, and you know what I mean? And then you're just like, oh, I got it. You know what I mean? It was embedded in you. No matter what, it looks like you was going to do it, right? You loved it.
Yeah. Because I described that I was hungry. I was hungry to do it.
Right.
That's the only way I can describe it, because I was hungry to... When I listen to tune, I'd be excited that I'll learn a new chord today. I'm going to play that tune and see if I can make those chords as well.
Right.
And you sit down and you break it down and you push your fingers in wherever they fit and make it work.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it was for me. Mm-hmm. It's only years later, like I said, Bigger used to take me one side and go, no, Bubblers, you have to have fingering. You have to learn the right technique for fingering. You'll never play that. And I'm trying to do that with three fingers. And God, no, you have to use all your fingers in a certain pattern. That's called fingering. And he said, no, you have to. You never had no training. I go, no, whatever's happening. I push my fingers in the keys or make them work. Mm-hmm. He goes, certain notes. He goes, that worked for majority of things, but for certain things that won't work. You have to learn fingering. Mm. And he sat me down and taught me it. I give him thanks for that. Wherever you're Bigger, if you're listening, give me one up for that. You know, because he didn't have to do that. He didn't have to show me that.
No, but he saw you had the potential. You know what I'm saying? You were doing something. It's like, well, hey, wait a minute. You didn't do this, which is a blessing. You know what I mean? You started from...
I remember, Bigger as that man used to play for Aswell and all them people there, and King Sons, everybody, him well up there, you know.
Yeah.
So even to take time for me as an upcoming youth to this at the time to say, no, you need Bubblers, you need to do this and do that. It needs to take time with me. Me and his brethren up to know music brothers forever. It's my brother that, no matter what one, is another man like that. There's about 10 or 12 men when we call him my musical brother.
Mm.
So you know, we grew up together, we nurture together, you know?
You worked closely with Aswad.
Yeah. Yes, I had 25 years with Aswad.
Wow.
Wow.
I was playing drums and playing keyboards and singing backing vocals as well.
And that's what I didn't know about you, you know?
I
didn't know you played drums.
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, well, there it is, too. I didn't know he played drums. We'll see that now.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what you do. Go to YouTube and tap in Ezra the Hammersmith Palais, and you'll see me in all my glory. That's when they had the dot turn around and all the hits there. I even had an afro then.
Okay.
No, I was about 25, 26 years old then. That was in our prime. Mm. And you see me there around the drums, around the keyboards, everything. You see me.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. As well, a live at Hammersmith Palais.
Mm. I'll check it out for sure.
I'm definitely going to check that out after. Yeah. So let me come back to schooling now. So after you're going to graduate school, right?
Mm.
And where is your mindset then? What are you thinking for yourself? Like, what am I going to do? Like,
Well, I always wanted to do school. I always, even when I was at school, I was doing little sessions here, you know, just trying to get my foot in on the music, even at school. Mm-hmm. So I had a little school band. It was me, Don Campbell, same with Dilly from Stingray. Uh-huh. And there's a famous duo, like a brother and sister, one called Buddy McKenzie and one called Candy McKenzie. Candy McKenzie was a great session singer and a keyboardist as well. Buddy McKenzie was a guitarist. He used to play amongst Sons of Jah, I think. I don't remember Sons of Jah with Trevor Bowen.
Yeah.
I don't remember
them. Yeah.
Yeah, but he used to play amongst them. But his little brother used to be the bass player with our little band. Mm. So let me go back a little bit. So we get brave one day. So we're going, boy, we want to play at school, you know. Me, Don Campbell and Dilly and Kenny, his name was Kenny, the bass player. So, which is Candy's and Bunny's little brother. So we're going, we want to play at school. So we arranged it one day. So we're going to actually play in front of the assembly.
Mm.
And you know, it was all great. We rehearsed, you know, before. But you see, when you're in front of the whole of your school, and you know, the teachers go, "Yeah, well, all right, this is Carlton, and this is really, and they're going to play us their song, whatever else." And they call themselves, we call ourselves Ilect, like, as you know, Ilect of God. We call ourselves Ilect. That's our school band name. And he goes, "I'm introducing Ilect." All I can say, if you smelt that stage at that moment, the amount of pooping and fire we might have been doing, we're so nervous. It just, the nerves just came down. We go, well, this is it.
Yeah,
we're here. We wanted it, and so this is it. But we played, and we played great, and we did a nice little show, but it was nerve-wracking. Then I said, oh boy, the amount of wind we passed on that stage. When I think about it, it's like, oh, man. But we're playing in front of the whole school, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, Donald, them time, they used to have long plaits.
Mm.
And he pulled out his plaits to make them look like dreads. Like, he looked like a very young Bob Marley.
Right.
So it was all in the kind of framework of this reggae band, with this young little reggae band.
Yeah.
But anyway, but my point is, when I was younger, we used to do little sessions, going here and there, not getting paid for it, just doing it for the love of it, basically. Yeah. And so when I left school, I had about two or three jobs, and I just didn't like it. I said, I can't see myself doing this 9 to 5. Even one of the jobs I got from the job center, and I was working at a printer's. And the printer, he had me for about a week. I'd be there cutting the papers, lining them up, putting the machine, inking the machine. And I said, I can't be doing this for like the next 10, 15 years. I can't. Mm. There must be more to life than this. And the guy I was working for, he could see it in me. He could see that I'm not cut out for this.
Mm.
So after a week, he goes, look, I'm going to send you back to the job center. I'm going to send you back with a good resume that you're a good worker. But I can see you're not cut out for this. And I want them to send me somebody who's more cut out for this. I can see your heart's not in it.
Right.
So I went back to the job center and then with a good resume. And they offered me jobs here and there. And I said, I just don't know. I want to do music. That's what I want to do. I want music. So, right, Ari, do you know BBMC?
Yeah.
The rehearsal place, BBMC, is literally around the corner from where I live.
That's right.
Before that was BBMC, that was, it was called Cherry Leisure. Right. And I used to do arcade machines, like Space Invaders and all those things from those days. So my job was to unpack the machines, line them up, plug them in, and play them. What a job! You know, playing Space Invaders all day. So even for that job, after a while, I got bored of it. I said, I was turning up late because I'd be trying to go to sessions and waking up, coming from sessions like 4 o'clock in the morning. I'd have to go get up for 9 o'clock to go to work. And even that, I was messing it up. So they fired me from that job. Mm. And my dad saw me dossing about doing all these odd things. And my dad said to me, what you do, Carlton? What you really say you do? Because, you see, I do all these things you said, you do music. But I know me can't see no money come. You know, I help me with no rent, you know, I help me with no bill. But what you say you do? By this time, I was about 17. He goes, what you say you really do? I said, well, I want to get into the music business. He goes, well, here we are. This is what my dad goes to me. He goes, I want you to pay me some rent now. Now, the first thing I'm going to say to you is, I don't want no police at my door. Meaning, I don't want you getting in no trouble. I don't want you to get in no drugs thing or not like that. I want you to look at honest work and bring home some wages.
Mm-hmm.
Some you can help towards my housekeeping.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just leave you after 16, 17 now, and I live here and I pay nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought my dad was the wickedest man on earth to do that to me. I thought he was the wickedest man. He's pressuring me now. But more time, when I do these gigs with these people, these things, all I come on was I get a kebab or a bag of chips, and that was it. That's all I got at the end of the night. My dad said, I don't want no police at my door.
Yeah.
If you get police at my door, you go and go out with them. So whatever you do, if you want to do music, if you want to do it so bad, make sure you get paid for it. That's what you're telling me.
Yeah,
yeah. I thought my dad was so wicked for that. I go, you're just pressuring me. But to this day, that's the best advice my dad has ever given me. Mm-hmm. It made me wake up.
Yeah.
It made me wake up. You can't be just dusting about just doing it for free. You got to draw the line with certain people. No, I'm gonna come and do this. Well, I need to be paid or not. I need to get you have to get serious.
Right.
So that's where it turned for me, where it turned from being the hobby into my career. Because I had to get serious with people. Like, if a man's calling me out and he's got a show, well, how much are we getting paid? How much is rehearsals? Okay, then I need to get my money up front or wherever it is. I'll be coming. I'll be setting up. But when I'm there, I don't want to be hearing about running down no man after no show for no money. I need to get my money.
Mm.
I've got to pay my daddy's rent. That's what I used to be telling them. I've got to pay my daddy's rent, so I've got to get my money. So that's where that career, I know when it ran a long-winded way, but
that's
to show you where I got serious in my career of music.
Yeah. Go ahead, Sharon.
Mm. So, when did you start getting paid now? So you're doing the gigs. You're doing. So I should say
I wasn't getting a lot of money, but I was getting some money.
Right, you dispense with all the other odd jobs because you're like, no, I'm not in it. So then now, get the little gig them, and you're getting your money. Yeah. You have your daddy the rent. How did that start? Now, like, what type of shows were you doing where they were able to pay you your money?
Say it again.
What type of shows were you doing, right? Like, where were you playing?
At the time, it was mainly local artists. I didn't know any of the top artists at the time. I was just mainly local artists, people up and coming like myself.
Mm-hmm.
But I just made it very clear that if I'm coming to work for you, or coming to play a gig, I need to be paid. If we agreed £5, then make it £5. Don't give me for £3.50 or whatever it is, whatever. Make sure my £5 is there. If I agree to a little price, then make sure it's there. because I'm coming to play. And when I play, I want to be paid. Right. And to this day, a lot of those promoters, they never liked me for that. They never liked me for that, because more time they make you man player, and when you don't play, the matters they go and check in next week, and next week never come.
You broke the trend.
Yeah, he was. Was doing the right thing, though. You was doing the right thing. So it's the end of promoters. Oh, promoters are usually the most shystiest people in business.
You have one or two good promoters, but the majority of them, they're very unsavory characters. And if you let them get away with it, they will burn you time and time again.
Yes.
Well, that was the era when that kind of thing was going on. As you will know, a lot of musicians and artists went through that, I would call it scam, you know what I mean? Where they'll perform and wouldn't get paid for it, you know? That was rife back in those days. So you kind of broke the mold.
You broke the mold, man.
Yes, but when Ruff Cutt was at its peak, I was the one who was in the control of getting the money. And we always just get our money. And the promoters, when everyone says, me and my friend, you answer them, fierce nut up. They're rolling my eyebrow, nut up, them fierce nut up, the fierce turn up our back way.
Everybody's cool face once they see you.
No, I deal with that for 2 days. You know? I said, yeah, well, you know, if you're going to deal with me, this is what this is going to be.
Aye, boy.
They never used to like me for that. They never used to, but my musicians that used to love me because they know they're going to get paid.
Yes.
They're going to get their money. More time when my musicians go on stage, they got their money in their back pocket.
Wow. Yeah.
I tell you.
That's how I used to do it. Because what it is, I treat, if I'm calling you to play for me, I'm going to make sure when I call, to this day, any musician I call, I go, boy, I'm never sure, you know, they come, they don't ask me about the money, because they know their money's going to be sorted out.
Yeah.
To this day. And I'm not even playing on the second. I've done gig for the last 10 years. But I'm sure if I call any one of them, they'd come.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't worry about the money, because they know I'm going to set their money right before they even go on stage. More time they have their money in their back pocket while they're playing.
Mm-hmm.
You're trustworthy. You were always honest.
I like to treat people like I like to be treated.
Treated, right. Right.
That's as simple as that. Right. To this day, if I got a session, even amongst my own musician, even amongst my own bona fide Ruff Cutt man, then, and I got some session where I make sure I got something I can give them before they come. I'm not going to just beg them for free. Mm. I just like that. You could, they'll do it for me for free, but I just want to know so I can give them something.
Right.
If I can't give you nothing, I'd rather tie my belt and wait.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just like that.
Yeah.
You know, old times say, old people say.
Yeah. Tie your belt. Yeah, that's true. So now.
Yeah, I'd rather do that. To this day, I'm not going to call you and got some work for you and why. And yeah, that this cliche word, why you want, no. I don't like when you give me that. So I don't want to give nobody that.
Mm-hmm.
Up to the end of the day, what called one of my good sisters in come and do some backing vocals for me. I make sure everything was set. When it's done, when you done play it, straight to a bank to bank transfer. Done.
Right.
No argument.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's the right way.
So so from that principle, I've always had, I like to treat people how I'd like to be treated.
Yeah.
So it's I've always been like that. So from I got that from years back with Ruff Cutt, anybody and then knows something to deal with me. Promoter fears bend up when I'm promoter fears bend up. They go, oh, me like that fat you did. I go, oh, I got a problem. I said, I'm not getting a problem.
Yeah.
And I always used to say to them, I'm providing a service for you. You see, like if you book the venue, if you book Brixton Academy.
Yeah.
You can't go in there until you pay their money up front. You can't go in there. When you book it and you pay your money, then you can go in there and set up. But you can't go in there unless you pay your money because you're providing a service.
Right.
I said, majority of the musicians I call, that's what we do for a living. We play music. We don't sweep road. We don't bake cake. We're not teachers or anything like that. We play music for a living. So when you don't give us all our money, that affects our liberty.
Mm.
Yeah.
And if we have an agreement to what we're getting paid and things like that, just pay us what we're supposed to get. And yeah. What it is, the promoter's always tired and boring and never make no money. God, that's not my business.
Mm.
When you make the money, I've said this to many promoters, when you make the money, you want to make the money. Because you ain't sharing what you made. And I'm not expecting you to. Just give me what I asked for, and that's it. So that means if you win, you win by yourself. When you lose by yourself.
True.
I can't be losing with you. When you win, you want to win. And when you lose, the world will lose.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm providing a service.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
My service is to provide a backing band for XYZ artists to come and perform.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the night, I don't wait till the end of the night. I make sure I get my money before I go on stage. Mm-hmm. Don't you realize there's many shows at Brixton Academy where Rough Cut's playing and you see the show late. why are you about on stage? Why do you think that is?
Mm.
Because they haven't paid us our money.
Right.
And I said, I got quite frankly, I'll pull down my keyboards with a crowd out there and go home.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to play and wait and go and chase you down for the next week and a half to get my money. That's not going to happen.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That is not going to happen. I'm here. We're set up. We're ready to play. The crowd's out there. That means I know you got money in your pocket.
Yeah.
So pay me my money.
Yeah.
I'm not in an argument with you. And some more time I give them a week before to pay me my money, or I say, you know what? After sound check, on the day of the gig, after sound check, I expect an envelope.
Yeah.
So when we're going, when it's time to go on stage, I'm not supposed to be looking for you. I'm supposed to just go on stage and do my job. I got my money.
Yeah.
And more times they don't do that. You got promoters running up and down like the headless chickens, like 2 or 3 hours before the venue is supposed to close because they got the money. I said, well, that's fine by me. I'll just go home. But I'm not going to go on stage.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They should make it mandatory that anybody who claims to be a promoter, manager of some sort, you've got to obtain a license, because it's clear that many were hustling the music.
But majority of the promoters in our reggae music, I say, are hustlers. Majority of them are hustlers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is.
And I'm trying to get them to get a license. That's like blowing. That's like peeing in the wind.
Yeah.
That's just not gonna happen. They ain't gonna abide by that.
Right.
I'm telling you, as a man who's been in the business right now for many years, they ain't gonna abide by that. So this is what I have to do. I have to go, I have to meet them at their level.
Yeah, yeah.
That's it. Well, this is what we need to be paid and so forth. I didn't mean to get into all of this, but these things need to be known. Because I don't talk about these things publicly, but the public don't know that there's many shows at Big Brixton Academy, players packed out with people, and the promoters going, boy, they ain't got the money in, the money typing, and this go, I gave you a week to sort out the money. Give me the week before. Give us our money the week before. Yeah. You're leaving it down to like the last 3 hours before the venue's supposed to close. I said, if the venue closes and we're not on stage, that's your fault.
Yeah.
Are you being warned?
Wow.
It's a beautiful thing, is it?
Yeah.
I'm frozen?
Yeah, okay.
I'm saying it's a beautiful thing that you're saying this. It's like, you don't worry about, you know, not talking about it. A lot of people don't talk about it. Many people don't talk about it. People, and some don't know. Being here in the US, I've seen it with a lot of major artists where I've even been on the stage with them. And then there's battling in the background because, like, where's their money? Mm. Because they wanted their money up front. The crowd is yelling for them.
Mm.
They're not going to go until they see that money. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, this is it. And the crowd's yelling, but they don't know. The crowd don't know what's going on. It's money wars at that backstage.
Exactly. I've seen it, so you're right.
And I don't get into it. I don't get into it. Really, you know what? I gave you a week. So we want our money a week before the gig.
Yeah.
So we can have everything sorted out. Then leave it. I said, right, you got to sound check on the day of the gig. You know what sound check is? When you check all the equipment and you check all the levels and everything like that before that's like before the gig, before the doors open up. Right. So you do all that before that. Right? You finish by 5-6 o'clock. The doors open at 7 or 8 o'clock. So by 5-7 o'clock, you're supposed to have our money then.
Right.
So you're waiting until 8 o'clock for us to go on stage or 9 o'clock to go on stage. The venue closes at 10, 11 o'clock. And at 9 o'clock, you're still running up and down looking for money. Then that's your fault.
Yeah.
Because I warned you a week before. I didn't bring it to you right now at the end of the day. I gave you chances.
Now I think it's very important that we get to the point where, you know, the bands you played with, because we know already that you were with Rough Cut, but before Rough Cut, there was a band. Now, the band escapes my mind with you, Don Campbell, and a few others in it. What was the name of that band?
Undivided Roots.
That's it. Tell me about that band.
Undivided Roots since pre-Rough Cut. Right. Why we came to, when we were Undivided Roots, it was like Don Campbell was lead singer.
Right.
And invaluable character, you know, I'll give you a little bit of background with me and Don Campbell. Me and Don Campbell, we went to the same infant school together. He's my oldest friend.
Right.
He's my bony friend, brother from another mother.
Yeah.
He's my oldest friend. So we went to separate junior schools. When we went to junior school, I went to another school and he stayed at his school he was at. Then we met back up in John Kelly School, which is high school.
Right.
We met up there back in high school. I'm going, I remember, because Donald used to live on my road. He used to live across the road from me, just a few doors from me when we were toddlers.
Right.
So we got really close together, because me and him now, I'll tell you this is very important, I'm going to tell you. Me and him now, when you talk to most musicians, drop on BS. Me and him was into rhythm sections. So we're talking about guitar, piano, that side of it. And we always used to listen to the Jamaican kind of rhythm sections, because they used to sound wholesome and thick and chunky and nice. And when we listen to tunes like from Channel One and from those studios, when you listen to those rhythms, they just sound... this day.
Yeah.
Me and Donald would listen to certain tunes and go, why are you hear that tune, eh? And me and him used to want to emulate that so badly.
Right.
And so we'd play it with these local bands, what we were playing with. And the first thing they would notice, go, hey, that all the musicians go, hey, all them, where them two look you they come from? They might sound like some yard youth. They might sound like, him have the little like chip, you know, me have the little organ, and we have one, you know. And we're emulating the kind of, the Jamaican kind of rhythm section. We weren't being generic. There's a piano, there's an organ. We're trying to create the sound on the record.
Right.
Foundation.
Okay, yeah, years forward, that we met with Tony Phillips. Tony Phillips was in the band. He had a band called Creation Rebel.
Oh, yeah.
I don't feel like Creation Rebel. Creation Rebel was like a kind of more punky avant-garde kind of reggae band. They were produced by a guy called Adrian Shewood. Adrian Shewood's still around now to this day. I work with Adrian Shewood quite a lot, actually.
Right.
He's a white guy. He's very, very nice guy. And so Tony was always saying, "Why him stay out, we play him, come, he used to come down and watch us playing down at Rough Cut, our rehearsal place, which was just a boiler room at the time. And he'd come down there and watch me and Donald playing in these little bands. And he just looked at the tour and go, hey, I like the way you're playing, you know. I have a little session. I would like you to come. Would you like to come and play? Me and Donald go, yeah, of course. You know, the time that when we're going over to this studio, which is very famous. If anybody will hear this name, Easy Street Studio. Anybody who knows anybody will know about this studio. Easy Street was a studio. That's where Carol Thompson is recorded. That's where... Trevor Trevor, what's his name? Trevor Walters did his hit tune, Love Me Tonight. It was a very, everybody's recorded, a lot of people is called, Winston Reed is recorded, everybody's recorded, Easy Street Studio. That was the studio at the time. So we went down to Easy Street, and we recorded a couple of tracks, nice tracks we did and so forth. And Tony goes, well, you know, would I like with for my band? Because he goes, what he finds in Creation Rebel is more of a dubby kind of punkish band, but he wanted a more traditional reggae band.
Right.
And when me and Donald are playing, go, yeah, this is what him want. Him want more, him want somewhere, some more like proper reggae. I go, okay, we'll do that. We're into that. So in the beginning, Undivided Roots is just me. No, Undivided Roots actually was Creation Rebel. But Tony goes, but let Creation Rebel go on as what they are. The original Undivided Roots was actually Creation Rebel.
Right.
And he goes, no, I'm gonna form this. Tony goes, I'm gonna form this new Undivided Roots now with Don Campbell and Carlton Ogilvie, Boblers.
Right.
So there's the three of us. Then down at the Sound Stonebridge where we are now, there's a lot of bands that come down there, little bands like myself. And Fish now is a man I know from junior school.
Fish Brown.
And Fish had his own band. And so we go, we like our Fish play bass, because that time Tony was playing bass, but he really wanted to play guitar.
Yeah, yeah.
So we invited Fish to come down and jam with me, and it was just a magical fit.
So
Fish ended up leaving his band and coming and joining our band.
Was Fagan with you at the time? Was Fagan with you guys at the time?
No. Fagan was there. We had a drummer who used to play for King Sounds and the Israelites. His name was Dennis Cook. So Dennis Cook was our drummer at the time. So we had Dennis Cook, me, Don Campbell, Fish Brown, and Tony Phillips. Right. And that's where Undivided Roots come from. That, and we had a percussion called that Bongo Dashi. Anthony Thomas's name is. So and that was Undivided Roots. Right. And we were going on good, and we were doing the backings as well. We were backing artists. And a lot of artists coming along, and they're liking, because they were associating us with the Jamaican sound.
I
don't know. We don't know how you don't do it, but you have that kind of Jamaican sound about us. But the thing is, we all kind of geared to that. All of us as musicians, we all wanted that. So we all geared to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that kind of English sound. But we go, that's great. But we want to emulate more of the Jamaican sound.
Right.
So that's what we were into. So. To cut a long story short, after a while, many years passed, and Donald wanted to go solo. Donald, he just wanted to the solo thing. I said, "Boy, I was really disappointed. My heart was broken because me and him has been going from high school, we're in our early 20s now. So I said, "Boy, if you do your, I just had to wish him well. I said, if you need help, when I'm here, I'm willing to help you same way. You know, we're not arguing. You just want to do your own thing. Okay, cool. So with that time, we had a studio in Austin, above a clothes shop. So even Donald's first tune, the See It In Your Eyes, that was recorded at our studio.
Okay.
I think Jazz were done the programming and it was all recorded at our place. So we're still, you know, still in each other's lives. And that he's got his solo career, but we're still helping each other out.
So it didn't end badly.
No, because we just said it didn't end in an argument. He just wanted to do his solo thing. I won't to go into the details too much, but
he
wanted to go into solo. So I said, you know, I was heartbroken personally because it's my bridging. But he said, I'm not leaving. I just want to do my own thing. I go, cool, no problem. So I said, well, if you need support, we'll support you the same way, which is what we did. So we recorded at our studio, and that's where your Eyes was recorded. And when he left the band, we were fishing around for a replacement to... That time, remember, we're doing backing as well, you know. But sometimes we're doing shows, and a man goes, well, so what are you doing? Are you performing at Underground Roots, or are you doing backing today? That's what he'd ask us. So we were backing band as well as Underground Roots. So when Donald left the band now, we said, "Boy, it's fine. It's hard finding a replacement for him." Mm. But you know, Donald's a very talented singer. You know, it's a hard. We tried out really numerous singers, and it just wasn't a fit.
Yeah.
So we decided to say, you know what, we're just going to be a backing band. Mm-hmm. And we changed the name to Rough Cut because that was the name of our rehearsal place.
Right.
Okay. So we changed the band name from Undivided Roots to Rough Cut as a backing band now, full-on right. backing band.
Right. Here's the funny thing about Undivided Roots, because like we all know, there was a couple of bands that were established in the UK. Cimarron's, which is one of the very first, you know, apart yeah. from Greyhounds, yeah. but, you know, Cimarron's yeah. was one of the first bands. They were always yeah. known, even though they were an established band within their own right, they came,
yeah.
they were better known as a backing band, unfortunately.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
However, they even backed up Bob Marley, I think, at one time.
That's right. Now, here's the funny thing about Undivided Roots, though. Undivided Roots, when you guys came out, even though you were backing, you were still known as Undivided Roots. You weren't, how do I put it? People will not know you as a backing band. You were known as Undivided Roots as a band. I don't know how you guys pulled it off, but you did.
Yeah, that was going for a few years, but like I say, we were dedicated and we were deep into it. And another thing I must add to you, that in that same rehearsal room in Stonebridge, we managed to convert it into a rehearsal room and a recording studio. We had a little 4-track studio in there, and one of the tunes I'll tell you which came out of there was you know, Junior English, who just passed away the other day.
Yeah.
We had a tune called Ready to Learn.
I knew it.
Yeah, that Ready to Learn. And we had and the same session was a tune called Tears of a Clown by Smokey Robinson. We did an idol version of that. But all those recorded at our 4-track studio in Stonebridge there.
Mm. Wait, tell me something. Junior said he went John Kelly too, right?
Yes, right. He went to John Kelly as well.
And Delroy Washington.
General Washington,
Tony
Potts, Brinsley Ford from Aswad, Tony Potts from Aswad. Yeah, a lot of musicians went to John Kelly, a lot. As I said to you, it's a very musical school.
Yeah.
When you went into the music block, when I went up to the music block, and we was in second year, you go to the fourth years, the fifth years, they're all playing. You're watching them all playing in front of you. And your mind's being blown.
We went to the wrong high school, mate.
You know it. We had Starkey Banton, though. At least we had Starkey.
We had Starkey Banton, yeah.
Yeah, our school was very musical. Like I said, yeah, Dora Washington.
Yeah.
Tony Pops of Aswad, Brinsley from Aswad. You mentioned it. I can't remember his name. You just mentioned
Delroy.
You just mentioned the name. I can't remember.
Okay.
Huh?
Delroy Washington, English. There was a whole lot.
Junior English, But they all went to John Kelly. It's a very musical school. They all left before I came.
Right.
But we knew about the heritage of the who were there before us.
Right. So let me unpack what you're saying now. So when Don Campbell left Undivided Roots. It left the void, so therefore I'm assuming you guys decided to create Rough Cut Band now. I'm assuming.
Yeah, because we were on the board of, sometimes we were using the name, while we were Undivided Roots, sometimes we were using the name Rough Cut to try and distinguish between the two, because people were getting confused. When we were going out as Undivided Roots, we were doing backing as well. We said, well, no, we've got to distinguish between the two. When we're going out to do backing work with an artist, let's call ourselves Rough Cut.
Right.
And then when we're doing with just Don Campbell now, that's in the later years, he said, let's go out as Undivided Roots. But when he left, we said, you know what, let's just carry on doing the backing.
Right.
The backing was quite lucrative for us.
Right.
That was our main source of income, to tell you the truth. We were doing lots of backing, lots and lots and lots of backing.
Still known as UK's greatest backing band.
Yes. greatest. We were a top band, for like 25 years.
Yeah.
Everybody, UK and Jamaican artists, from Martha Griffiths, from Beres Hammond, you name it.
So how does it go? So before I ask you this question, tell me about how Tony Phillips became part of the band.
No, Tony Phillips is the man who actually instigated the whole thing. He was the one, like I said, he had Creation Rebel. And then Creation Rebel, when he was in Creation Rebel, they were more of a punky, dubby, reggae band. Sort of thing.
Okay.
And they were doing the college circuits and that. And he goes, he saw me and Donald playing at Stonebridge. I'll reiterate again. Me and he used to rehearse at Stonebridge himself.
Right.
There was another backing band called Freedom Fighters at the time. Freedom Fighters were the top backing band at the time.
Right.
Freedom Fighters.
Right.
Right. So, and Tony was in Freedom Fighters as well. So, but he used to come down there and watch my little band play with a little band called Family Band. And he used to watch us play. He goes, boy, we really like the way we're going to play. So much so, he'd be watching us playing and he'd come in and just plug in his guitar and start playing.
Mm.
I wouldn't invite him to play. He'd just start plugging in his guitar and start playing. And I go, what's all that about? He goes, yeah, but the man sound good, you know, I think some like drum with the man them. And I'm saying in my mind, yeah, it'd be nice to ask, you know. But anyway, so he came to us and he asked me and Donald, he's doing a session. And that's how we started. He goes, I want to form a new Undivided Roots, but the old Creation Rebel, and this one's going to be more traditional bass,
right?
Not punky dubby, more traditional bass, reggae band,
right?
And that's what. So Tony's the man who actually instigated, and then me and Donald joined him.
I'm with
you. And then there was three of us, and then it grew from there. It's just the three of us.
Right. I'm with you. Okay.
Yeah, you got it now.
Yeah, I'm with you now. So you backed so many people, Marcia Griffiths, so many. So how did that go? So your name was becoming renowned within the industry, all over the place. People would just, you know, say, let's call Rough Cut and get them to back you. How did that scenario go?
Say it again.
How did the scenario go with many people that you banked? Were people call you guys
it's
up?
It's just word of mouth.
Okay.
It's just word of mouth. People get to know, and then what it is, the artist will get, and it's word of mouth in Jamaica. They'll go, like Marcel will go, boy, the local band, they work with Jamaica in England, you know, them song good, you know. And then Beres go, yeah, we work with them song good, you know, and the word gets around in Jamaica. So when they come into England, we're the first port of call they want to come to.
Right.
They'll come to us first. And if they can't get us, they'll go to another band. But they always came to us first.
Right.
So and it's basically word of mouth.
Because back in the 70s, Cimarron's was the band to go to at the time.
That's right.
More Cimarron's.
I remember, Cimarron's is just up the road from me.
Yeah.
When you think of that, I don't know nothing about that. I was a little youth. I was a little 78-year-old. They were up the road from me. Literally 2 minutes walk up the road from where I live right now.
Right. There's so much to talk, you know, about your career. We can never fit it all in within that time span. And I'm eager to know a couple questions. How did you get to work with Maxi Priest and Shabba?
Shabba, all right, I'll tell you, with Shabba, before he broke out anything like that, he came here to do a show. And it was at Wembley. Do you remember Wembley Town Hall? It's something else now, isn't it? Somebody else owns the building now. But Wembley Town Hall, he came there to do that. And I was working with a young drummer called something Spence. I can't remember his name now. Something Spence. A young drummer. Me, a guitarist, a drummer, and a bassman. I can't remember who the bassman was. But it wasn't undervalued. It was like some pickup musicians. And when we came along, we were working with Shabba. That time I think it was his first time coming to the UK. Before he had Grammy nominated and all that, when the first time he arrived.
Mm.
And it was a good show, good turnout and everything like that. We played with him and he had the tune, what was the tune? The first tune that brought me to the attention, I can't remember it now. If I remember it, I'll tell you what it is. But we did all those tunes, and it was really good. But with Maxi, I used to do work with there's this guy called legendary guy. He's dead now. He passed away about 20 years ago. He passed away now. His name is Erskine Thompson.
Okay.
Have you mentioned that name amongst anybody who knows anybody who don't know? Oh yeah, I remember Erskine Thompson. All right, he used to manage Loose Ends.
Okay.
He used to manage Sly and Robbie. He used to manage Maxi Priest. He was one of those guys in that arena.
Yeah.
So basically, I'm gonna try and give you a brief history about Maxi. Maxi was working with Paul Robinson, which we know as Barry Boom.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Barry Boom was his producer. But early hits like Trauma Khan and Should I? Those were all produced by Barry Boom, by Paul Robinson. So the first two albums, when Barry Boom got signed through Erskine Thompson, got signed to 10 Records, which was Virgin. Barry Boom had the first two albums. Which is called You're Safe and something else. I can't remember what the album was called. After that now, Maxi tried to blow up. Really, really blow up. And so I was doing a couple of shows with him. We were doing a couple of shows with him as well. But he was there in big. So then Erskine Thompson goes, boy, we're working on this album with Maxi's third album. And he said, boy, Bubbles, I want you to play a couple of tracks. I said, okay, cool. But just play keyboards. Then what it is, they were working in about 3-4 months. It goes, we're coming to the end of the contract, but we got one track to do. And I want you to do it. Because we're having trouble doing this track. And the album's called Bonafide.
Yeah, I have that album. Yeah.
Right, the Bonafide album. And the track's called Human Work of Art. Now, unbeknown to me, they record that tune about 6 times before me. But Maxi Priest hates that tune. He just hates the song. So when I came to the studio, I just bought myself this brand new keyboard and then a sequencer and everything. So I was just learning to use it. So I got the drums up on it. I didn't put no bass down or anything like that. And I got the drums down and I go, right, okay. So I put the keyboards down. But Erskine got the studio and goes, this time we're all working on the 10 records now, you know, this is money I want. We're Virgin Records. I go, okay. So I go, this is the first time I'm actually going to encounter and kind of really, cause before we used to talk with Maxi, but we just rehearse and do the show and gone. But now I'm going to actually converse with him. So we got to the studio, I record a track, I get my guitarist, I got a good guitarist in mind, his name is Stanley Andrews, world-renowned Stanley Andrews. If you know anybody, ask anybody about Stanley Andrews, he's actually my son's godfather. Great guitarist.
Right.
So I got him to play some guitars. I got Don Campbell and a girl called Beverly Skeet. If you know anybody in the business, talk about Beverly Skeet. She's a donstress at backing vocals. But I know her sister, which is Valerie, who's in a woman band called Akaboo.
Okay.
Akaboo, the woman band.
Yeah.
Her sister, that's Valerie's sister, Beverly Skeet.
Ah.
And so when Erskine and I introduced me to Beverly, now she's a donstress. So I'm a man now. I know my little backing vocals. I know a couple of things. So I called Don. I said, Erskine goes to me, well, get the backing vocals done. We get the song done because I'm going to call Maxi down to do a guide vocal for you because I'm having problems with Maxi. I go, why? What's that? He goes, don't worry about it. Just get the track done. So I got the track done. I've got the music all together. I couldn't get a bass line together for some reason. Every time I played my bass line, it sounded like some old man bass line. I said, no. I can't. So I go from Erskine goes, call Mafia. I go, well, I got my bass player. He goes, no, call Mafia. I go, okay, I'll call Mafia then. call Mafia Mafia, listen to the tune one time. I go, yeah, man, Mafia, the only line that you have put down. Puts on the bass line. He's like, yeah, the tune is all set now.
Yeah, yeah.
Maxi comes down, we speak for about 3 hours.
Mm.
Then it's time to go on the mic to sing. He goes, Bubblers, I'm telling you the truth, I don't like this tune. I go, well, Maxi, look, I don't know what you like or what you don't like. I've just been commissioned to do this tune. So let's just finish the tune and, you know, everybody just finish the work.
Yeah.
He came in, he sang about 2 lines and he goes, that's it, he's gone. I go, come on, Maxi, man.
Jesus.
He goes, Bubblers, I don't like this tune, I'm going. I go, Maxi, just finish it. He left.
Mm-hmm.
He left me with a half a song. So, but it was enough for me to do the backing vocals. I'm going to get back to Beverly now. So,
right.
Beverly comes in and I called Donald. I said, Donald, you know, I trust Donald because Donald's wicked on backing vocals. So I trust him. I said, Donald, I work with this girl, Beverly, which is Valerie's sister. You know? He goes, yeah, I've heard of her, you know. I go, yeah, well, you know, like, we can work together and try and get these backing vocals done at least.
Yeah.
So she comes in, you know, humble and everything, nice vibes. She listens to the tune. So I give her my ideas. She goes, yeah, that sounds all right. But what if we do it like this? She gives me 101 versions of how to do it. And they're all wicked.
Wow.
All her ideas are wicked, you know. And I said, my mouth dropped. I said, well, she goes, no, but what about this? What about this? What if we do it like this? What if we do it like that? I said, you sure about that? I got too much ideas here. So she goes, all right, let's try this. She put on, and she goes, if you sing it like this, and she comes in this kind of Luther Vandross kind of vibe.
Right.
Donald had to keep up with her. He had to keep up. it was the greatest experience for me to learn to teach me
right.
the rudiments of how to do backing vocals. Her right. lessons right. has been with me to this day.
Mm. Brilliant,
like, incredible. So yeah. we got the backing vocals done. Her name is on Facebook. Her name is Beverly Fizer now, I think, because she's married. Her married name is Fizer, but her real name is Beverly Skeet.
Right. Right.
She's a lovely person as well. But she's a monstrous at backing vocals. Anyway, so we got the track done. Maxi comes in and give me all his grief. He goes, Bubblers, I'm gonna sing the tune down from top to bottom 3 times.
Mm.
I go, well, so what does that mean? He goes, right, when I sing it 3 times, you make a composite from the 3 tracks. That means each track's running 3 times, then I've got to, while it's playing, I've got to make a new track, a fourth track, and make a composite from the 3 tracks onto the fourth track, the best parts of the 3 tracks.
Right.
You wow. understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you've got three takes, and you've got a free channel, which you've got to make the best takes from out of those 3 takes to make one take on a fourth channel.
Right.
Because I'm not coming back. And that's what I had to do. I had to literally stay there like a whole day editing. And that time you're editing on tape. You're not on computers.
Yeah.
You're editing on tape. So I got to edit these vocals them and set that and what you hear on the album is the finished product. When they because the record company wasn't having it. All the other versions they didn't like them, but for some reason they accepted my version, and that's how I started to work with Maxi.
Right,
but that's how when I started to work with him, it was under stress.
Wow.
Yeah.
I tell you what I'm gonna do. That work that track you were working on is called Human Work of Art, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm just gonna play a few bars of that particular track.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Bear with me a second. Let me just get it up here. Here we go.
Yes,
I keep on forgetting the switch. All right, so that was a false start, and in comes the original start.
Yeah.
I don't know why. It's funny how people hate certain songs. It's like, I absolutely love it, but, you know, I've never heard
a man who just didn't like the song.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you another thing as well. That song was done back 1990.
Mm.
Right. I done a track with Maxi in... He recorded a song for me in 2019 on the album. I can't remember. The album was called, which was the title track of, which is my tune called, I can't remember the name of the song. Yeah. The title track of the album, which
right.
The album was nominated for a Grammy.
Wow. Okay.
Because in 2019, I think Toots ran it because, you know, Toots died that year.
Okay.
Toots and Maytales, he died. So he got the Grammy that year. But it's called, But it is, there's a title track of the album.
Bonafide Love?
No, it's called It All Comes Back to Love.
It all comes back to love.
Oh, It All Comes Back to Love. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's the title of the album. That album was nominated for a Grammy 2019.
Right.
And what it is, so I'm going to Maxi, when he's telling me, I'm finally a Grammy nominated producer.
Mm.
He goes, no. He goes, the first album you did with Human Hair Broker Art was on Bonafide. That was also a Grammy nominated album. I go, I've been twice over and I'm knowing this now 30 years later.
Mm. Oh, wow.
Two times Grammy nominated producer. Grammy nominated, not the Grammy winner, but Grammy nominated.
Yeah.
That was the Human Work of Art, which was on the Bonafide album, which was nominated for a Grammy, and this one in 2019, which is It All Comes Back to Love,
right?
Which was nominated for a Grammy. Majority of the album was produced by Shaggy. I produced this track. And Max used to come to me and goes, Bubblers, I need some tracks. And I go, I'm not giving you no tracks. All you do is take my tracks and lean them in a corner. He goes, Bubblers, I'm listening to some tracks, man. So I sent him that track. And he goes, I like it. And he wrote to it.
Right.
Then he goes, yeah. So when you put it out, I go, boy, cause I brought the music originally for Berries.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But I didn't get to Berries because Berries is a very difficult man to get a hold of more time.
Right.
You know, Beres knows me and everything like that, but he's just a very difficult man to get hold of. So I didn't get around to Beres. So he calls me up about 3 months later after he finished the song with me, for me. And then he goes, boy, Bubblers, I'm doing an album with Shaggy, but I like the track so much, I want to put it on the album, what we're doing with Shaggy. I said, cool. Then he phones me about 2 weeks later. He goes, boy, I like the track so much. I want to make an entire track of the album. I said, wow. I said, okay, then. And the album, the next thing I know, the album's been nominated for a Grammy. So it's two Grammy nominations I've got in my lifetime.
Amen. And well-deserved as well, you know.
But thank you very much.
But before this conversation is over, let me just ask you about Drummy Zeb. Tell me about your time with Drummy Zeb. What are your memories of the great
Drummy man? Drummy Zeb is a laugh. Time with him is just pure laughter. Great guy. Great musician. Brilliant musician. And great stage man. He's as a stage musician.
Mm-hmm.
I've been on many tunes with him, like when you're playing on stage, where he goes into this dub thing, where he's being dubbed, and you don't know where he's going to take you.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know where you're going to end up, and you don't know how you're going to finish a song. But he's got a way of wrapping it up where you just know what's going to happen.
Mm.
He's great at that. He's a brilliant person. We had such a laugh on the road. We laughed constantly on the road. Constantly, he's another man of my musical brother. I met him when I was in my school uniform, going to a studio. He was playing a session. That time, the session players were between Matumbi and Aswad.
Okay.
And Dennis Bobo was controlling the session. There's a bit of studio called Gooseberry.
Okay.
Which is in Soho, which is in Chinatown in London. That's with the studio, but it was the main studio before Easy Street took over. Right. It was Gooseberry. And Gooseberry was, when I went down there, I was 14 years old. And I was, we was invited by Patrick Kahn. Patrick Kahn used to run Arawak Records in Harsden.
Mm.
Arawak Records was the one who put out Silly Games.
Ah.
And okay. and Little Way Different by Errol Dunkley.
It's
a way different.
Sorry. Mm. Where was Arawak Records?
In Harsden, Craven Park.
Never knew that ever.
Right by Harsden Library there.
Okay, I know it.
Oh, wow.
And then it became All Ears.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow, you remember All Ears?
Yeah.
Yeah. That was Arawak Records. That was run by Patrick Kahn. Patrick Kahn invited us as youths. I was 14 at the time. Sam Dilly and Don Campbell are all together. And he invited us to come down to Gooseberry because he wanted to record us. I went down there, I met Drummy for the first time.
Right.
I was 14 and he was tall. He had a big crumbly coat. And then he had Dennis Bovill down there. He had Webster Johnson. You know, Webster Johnson died about 4 or 5 years ago.
Right.
He bought for Matumbi.
Right.
I met him down there. And it's like, you know, you're starstruck. You're in the studio, you're starstruck with all these people you read about or you listen to a record.
Mm-hmm.
Dennis Bovell, Drummy Zeb, Tony Gadd. All of them was there. They had a session before we had a session.
Right.
So we're just watching them.
Right.
As youths, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I first met Drummy.
Right.
But we always remind each other of that when our first meeting. But Drummy was a laugh. He's a real, he's a lovely guy.
Yeah.
Lovely guy. He's pure jokes and laughter with that man on the road. Lovely guy.
Yeah.
To the stand.
But great musician, great, talented musician. Talented.
Mm-hmm.
Unbelievably talented.
Any man who can sing and drum at the same time as my salute.
Precisely. Yep. Any man that
I used to do that as well.
Imagine.
I learned from him by watching him. Because I'm on stage, you know. If you see me on that same show I'm telling you about, I'm doing back and forth as well.
Wow.
They got their money's worth out of me, I tell you that.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
Go on, Sharon.
No, I was just going to say, so, you know, working with Drummy Zed, it must have been an immeasurable loss when he left us, because I was a big Aswad fan. Big, big Aswad. Like, that's a huge loss.
Well, I want to tell you from my point of view, it wasn't just a musician and a great man. He's my brethren.
Yeah.
I can't say any more than that. He was my brethren.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'll give you one some information. One time they were trying to break America. Just after they did the Don't Turn Around, they were trying to break America.
Right.
When I talk about breaking America, they're trying to break into the American scene.
Yeah, crossover.
Like how Steel Pulse did.
Yeah.
So
we got a tour. This tour was 9 weeks long.
Wow.
We did, America's got 50 states.
That's
we
right.
did 46 states in 9 weeks.
Wow.
46 states.
Wow.
We had 6 days off. We had 6 days off in 9 weeks.
Wow.
So I'm trying to show you that when you're not, regardless of all the other shows I did with him, when you spend that time on the road with a man,
and
the whole band, as you said, and the whole band, we all stick together. We were all brothers on the road, and we were getting the pittance of money, but we were on the road. Mm-hmm. You become, it's not just musicians, you become brothers on the road.
Yeah.
What I'm saying to you is that my brother is my musical brother.
Yeah.
We were eating and drinking out of each other's pockets for that 9 weeks.
Yeah.
Because we weren't getting no great money. We were trying to break America. So we were getting a minimalist of money.
Right.
But it was the greatest experience I've ever had. Because you're touring the width and breadth of America, including Hawaii. Hawaii is the 50th state.
Mm-hmm.
So we did 46 out of the 50 states of America, all right, all.
Jeez.
That's so great. I'm trying to show you, sir. It's just not a man I know. It's my brethren.
Yeah.
And that's just the 9 weeks I'm talking about. I'm not talking about all the other years in between. I'm just talking about how close we became even on that tour.
Yeah.
So it's a loss for me. It's a loss.
Yeah. A huge loss. Yeah,
it's big. It's an immeasurable loss. Understandably so. We're all fans still to this day. So I just wanted to... That's a question I wanted to ask, because in your bio it states how long you've been working with them so long. You know what I mean? Of course, there's a camaraderie, brotherhood. There's a thing there, but losing him was a shocker. It was definitely a shocker.
Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
I tell you the truth, something personal. I'm going to tell you something personal. Mm. I've been at this door where over the last... Say three of, I'm 10 years out in my sickness, but I'm kind of stabilized now.
Mm-hmm.
There was a point where I thought I'd leave all of them. I think I wouldn't be here. I think I'd leave them.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a point where in my life where I was that bad, I wasn't expected to live after a certain point, but I've stabilized over the years. And when you're in that drummy part, I think that man got years to live. Years to live.
Yeah.
You know? So I'm just saying, life is a funny thing. You just don't know.
It really is.
You just don't know.
Yeah. Because I used to buck him up in Labbit Grove.
Me too.
Because that was his stomping ground anyway.
Yep.
That's right.
I always used to see them in Labbit Grove. Look, hey, how you doing? True.
Yeah.
Me too.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So it was a shocker, but we praise soul, rest in peace. There's so many questions that we'd love to ask you, but before we...
We might have to do that for part two. You might have to do that for part two.
We're
going to... We are doing a part two.
Yeah,
As long as you agree, we have to bring you back.
Yeah. I have no problem with that.
Yeah, but before we end this particular conversation, just tell us briefly in about 5 minutes. Tell me about New Age music.
Right, New Age music. I started that many years ago, about 1983-84.
Mm-hmm.
That's a matter of fact. And I put out a tune by an artist called SLIM BATSON. a tune called Push Push.
Yeah. Push, yeah. Push, yeah.
That's my first tune I ever released by myself.
Right.
So that time, how can I say that? One of our main people in our organization had some time at Her Majesty's services, I should say. Mm. That's the best way I can put it. So it kind of put a dampen on what we were doing, or stop to what we were doing. I said, I don't want to stop. I need to do something.
Yeah.
So we had a little studio, our little four-track studio. I said, let me try and do something. So I talked to Slim, and I decided to record this tune. And we recorded it, and that's the first tune I put out. And I put our next tune by an artist, which is my son's mother. I don't like to say baby mother. I say my son's mother, and her name was Theresa Jae. Tune called "Take Me in Your Arms and Love Me" by Gladys Knight of Pips originally.
Oh, okay.
So I put that as a regular version of that. It did okay as well. So, so I said, And after a while, I got so busy with other people's work, I just parked the label, just parked it. Parked it for like 20 odd years. Wow. And then what it is, when I got really sick and I couldn't do anything, I was in the hospital, laid up for 3 months. And I just had the thought, it just gave me time to think. I go, you know what? I need to regenerate my label.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because we've got Rough Cut, but Rough Cut's, well, I'm part of that, but I need to have my own thing. Mm-hmm. Not selfishly, but I just got my own things I need to project. Mm-hmm. So I said, let me resurface the label. And that's what I did. I resurfaced it in 2013. And I released vinyl. That's my first and only last set of vinyl. I released a tune, a series called Love is a Treasure, the Liat rhythm. Love is a treasure.
That one. Okay.
Yeah. I think Love is a Treasure, but it was sung by Victor Romeo Evans.
Oh.
And there's subsequent versions, like about five or six versions of it.
Yeah.
That's when I regurgitated the label. But that's basically my own project.
Right, and
that's basically my baby.
Tell people where they can find your music online.
It's a digital store, a digital record shop, digital website, which is newedgemusic.com, which is NUEDGE music MUSIC.com. newedgemusic.com, new as in N-U, newedgemusic.com.
Yeah.
And that's where you find my music. And you'll find snippets on there. There's a 30-second snippet of every single song on there. So you can pick from there. And it's not for free. You have to download it. So you have to buy it. It's a purchase. I tell most DJs, look, if you like my song, buy it. If you don't like it, don't buy it. But I have to pay these singers and all the people who voice for me. And it'd be nice to give them something after 6 months or so of sales. But if I just keep giving out, I'm making the tunes for the DJs and not for the public.
Yeah. And I buy from the website. It's very, very safe, you know what I mean? And it's very, very quick and responsive.
My website has a HS with an S on it, the HTTS. It's got, right. So it's safe, it's secured.
Yeah.
So Sharon, let's quickly.
But like I say, I'll say to for all those DJs listening.
Yeah.
Please support the business. Support the business.
Mm-hmm.
Support. If you like a tune, buy it. Don't keep begging. I don't know where these DJs got these attitude where they have to beg a tune or anything. Well, I'm playing your tune. Support the thing.
Yeah.
Support it.
Yeah.
If you like it, buy it and support it. It's only about £1. You a pack of RZA costs you more than that.
Yeah.
And you wouldn't pay £1 to the support the artist. Then come on now, man.
Yeah. I think we need.
There's just not enough of that. There's not enough of that where we support each other. There's become a attitude where DJs get tunes for free, and when they get them for free, they just play it once or twice and throw it down in the corner.
Yeah.
But you see, if they buy it, they're more likely to play it because they buy it.
For real.
Yeah.
Yeah, Bubla, send me that new tune there. Send it to me quick.
Yeah.
I tell him, said, this is the website. Go on there, and if you like it, buy it. If you don't like it, don't buy it. That's it. I'm in no argument with nobody.
That's right. That's right.
I would just like to know that I can give my artist them a royalty statement or some money at the end of 6 months or a year, you know, for their work, what they're paying. Yeah. But the way it's going right now, I can't give them anything.
Right, right.
But no DJs, they play the tune, and if they do play it, they play it once and twice because they get it for nothing. They get it for free.
Right.
Yeah.
If they buy it, they're more likely to play it because they bought it.
For real. I tell you what we want to do very, very quickly, Bubblers, because time is against us. Sharon, can you conduct the last phase of the show, please?
The last phase of the show, I know there's a lot of questions, but we're really going to have to wrap it up due to the time. So I know a couple of questions out there. If somebody wants to ask one question, like not a long question, a short question, if you want to, then please unmute now.
Now is the time.
Now is the time to do it.
Who has a question?
Who had a question?
Bubla.
All right. Jerry.
Jerry Harris.
Yeah, man. Bubla.
Hey.
Yeah, man. I remember you came on English Pound Radio before and I spoke to you. But, you know, back from Omega Studio days, you know what I mean? You might not remember me. But I was playing with Larry Professor.
Wow.
Yeah, I was playing with Larry Professor, Professor Basie.
Yes, and of Michael. Course I remember. Yeah, he's passed away now.
Yeah, I know. And Michael was the keyboard player. And then another drummer, I forgot what his name was. He used to play for Mikey Dredd too, you know? But back then
Leroy.
Yeah, Leroy. Yeah. So me, Leroy, Stanley was busy with you guys. You know what I mean? Playing guitar. So I was the guitar player with Michael, Leroy, Professor Larry. And we used to work with Mikey Dredd and all that. And we used to do session at Omega Studio with Blacker Dredd and all that kind of stuff. You know what I mean?
Okay.
And Bertie was the engineer. But at that time, you were busy with doing your thing. With your thing over there. So you just passed by in Omega Studio, I remember. And we were rehearsing for a show with Juna Delgado and I think the other guitar player did show up, Alan Weeks. You know,
okay,
and
Alan, beloved Alan Man.
Yeah, and the show didn't happen. Ray Sandy was on the show because the promoter wind up making money just from the sound system. And he ran away with the money. You know what I mean?
The usual thing.
Yeah, so I've been seeing you all the time. Even when you came on that long tour, and especially you was on that show. I think you was on the Sunsplash tour with I came to Radio City Music Hall with drummer
Zed. That's right, the same American tour. Yeah, same American tour.
Right. Yeah, Michael was with you guys and stuff. So I crossed paths with you, but you know, every time I meet up with you, you're busy because, you know, you're the main guy who doing the drums, doing the stage, and, you know, you're flipping between performances, you know what I mean? So when you said you got you got used up, you really did got used up because...
Yeah, they used me up. Boy.
Yeah, you're flipping between things, you know what I mean? Between
keyboards and drums.
When Tony Pops was
playing bass, well, I'm singing tune, I was playing the keyboard bass while he's singing.
There you go. So you were like the main ingredient in Aswad, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, over the years, I respect your work, man. And you know, as a person, also not just your work, just your personality behind the music, you know what I mean?
You've never been an
arrogant person. You've never been like you're a caregiving person. Mm. So I respect that.
Yeah,
man,
I try to be mindful of that.
Right. You know, so because your parents raised you right. So you got it. I'm in Jamaica speaking to you right now. I'm down in Jamaica speaking to you. I just came down here last week. I'm going back to the US. I live in the US actually. You know what I mean? Okay. So hopefully that we will pass, I will pass part with you some other way. I was in London in November, but I didn't really, I just went to Dub Vendor and a couple of places and all that. You know what I mean? It was like a family trip, you know what I mean? So hopefully that we will cross paths again and take good care of yourself. And I'm glad that everything is stabilized with you, you know?
Okay, thank you very much. And likewise all right. to you, sir.
And thank all you, the Jerry. Blessing, yeah? All mm-hmm. right, take care.
Bless. Bless.
Yeah. Bless. Yeah, yeah.
Respect. Who else wants to say something? Who else? Now is the time to say, oh, forever hold your peace.
Mr. Bushell, go and press a button. Is Mr. Bushell, you wanted to say something?
You'll have to unmute if you do.
Can't hear you.
Oh, maybe he doesn't. Oh, doesn't.
I do okay. Mute.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes.
Okay, so I'd just like to big him up, man. He's a great person, like he said. Yeah, man, Wagwan. And as usual,
let me tell you, this guy is my brethren. I used to ride shotgun with him back in the day when we are nobody,
and vice versa.
You're right.
Remember going to Easy Street?
Yeah, man.
I'd like to big you up, man, because like it's always said, we need to tell all those that do good things here and now, right now, you've done a great job and you're still doing that. So thank you very much for all that you've helped me. Blessing.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Leroy. God bless you, brother. Thank you.
Thank you, Leroy. That was sweet.
Right? Really anybody sweet. Else? Anybody else? Sharon Bentley, go ahead.
Yes, Bubblers. Hello. I too am very amazed by your enthusiasm on this music, in the music industry. You have done so much things, not only with the musician and the band, but the way you talk about it, the passion that you have for the whole thing.
Yes. I do love it. I make no apologies for that. I do love it.
And I we can feel that. We can see it. Now, the question that I wanted to ask you, because you said something earlier, you said they should pay before you enter the stage. I agree 100% with that. Because I've seen artists come here. Some of them come here, they get this, oh, we'll pay you. Yeah, and when they come at the end of the show, the promoter is not there. And they have to be running up. And I myself, the funny thing about it, there was about 3-4 years ago, there was a show in my city. And they had this, I think that it's put on by some youths, but they get the money from the government to pay the artists. And the artists, they played, they did their job. Only at the end of the evening, they couldn't find a person who to pay them. And they're, who are they coming to? Me. Oh, Sharon, you see him? You see him? I have to go look for them.
Mm.
You know, and it is sad that artists has to go through such tribulation. But I also can remember we went to a Uri concert. He was well prepared. He was even there. He didn't show up on the stage. Why? Because the promoter did not pay him. So everything that you have said during your interview here, yeah, I agree with you 100%. Yeah. You cannot work without money. You have to feed your family. And the second question that I want to ask is, what would you say to these young people now? Because you have gone through so much. You have seen the ins, you have seen the outs, and you have seen the difference. Okay. What would you say to the younger generation now who is trying to follow your footsteps or trying to get into the business, not knowing the real ins and outs of it?
Okay. I'm going to repeat what I said earlier. I'm going to tell it. This is basic steps.
And you have to do it in 2 minutes. Do it in two minutes, Bubblers.
I'll try. The basic steps I'm going to tell you. When you're collecting money or you're going to do a show, I'm talking from a show point of view, or a performance, you need to collect an advance. If you when you collect that advance, to collect the rest of your money, you give them 7 days before the venue, or you tell them, say, you need to get paid after sound check. You can put that in writing 7 days before, so that there's no excuse when it comes to the day. That they have 7 days notice. So that means that if you don't play, you've had your notice. And if my money's not there, then I'm going home. And when people see you serious like that, they know not to mess about with you. And that's what I've had to do over the years. Like I said, promoters, they fierce bend up when they see me.
Yeah.
Because they know I'm not playing. And when I got people with me, I got 5, 6, 7, 8 people I got to account for. So I advise them that when you're doing shows, get an advance up front. And if you don't get an advance, you go, okay, this is what's going to happen. At the end of soundcheck, that means when you're at the end of soundcheck, you're there, you're at the venue, you're ready to play.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you give them 7 days notice that you need to have my money at soundcheck. And if it's not there, if they don't give you your envelope before it's time to go on stage, you go home. Just go home. Call it a loss. But you ain't going to be chasing and running after them.
Yeah.
No matter what they tell you.
Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to end it there. I wish we had more time. But
I'm afraid you might have to carry him back.
That's not fair. That's not fair.
Because there's a lot more questions to ask.
Yeah. Of course, but there's no time, otherwise we get kicked off, Sharon. So that's
Bubblers, we have to listen. We're going to reschedule because you have to come back sooner rather than later. There's so much to unpack. There's many more questions, a few more in the chat box as well. But we love and respect who you are. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your schedule, because it is an honor. And we want to make sure you got your flowers today. And I hope that you feel like you got that, and that you received the love that we have to bestow upon you. You're an amazing gentleman. And we can't wait for you to come back. We're going cut it up about it and schedule the next one.
I'm ready when you're ready.
All right, so I'm going to leave it to you guys to set the date and then let me...
I'm going to be calling you. I'm going to call you. Yeah? Bubblers,
okay.
All right, so Bubblers, God bless you, brother. Sharon has said it all.
Likewise to you, sir.
And I really enjoyed my time with you today. God bless you, brother.
All right. Thank you very much.
All right. We're going to end the show unconventionally just by me saluting the real general.
Bubblers.
If you enjoy the content we provide on this YouTube channel, then why not help us by subscribing to SPRB Radio Podcast? Thank you in advance.